On this week's episode of Fireside Chat, we focus on the GM switch. Jay Feaster and John Weisbrot are both out. We're going to look at who some possible replacement options are, who the Flames might hire for that role, what Brian Burke's role is going to be going forward, and also if Jay Feaster was the right guy for the job. Should he have got fired? Should they have kept him on? This whole episode, all about the GM switch, so stay tuned. This is Fireside Chat, episode 33. We need more truculence. Recorded December 17th, 2013.
Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another episode of Fireside Chat, featuring Dan, Matt, and Lucas.
And we're coming off the heels of the 2-0 loss to the Boston Bruins. The Flames just can't catch a break in that arena. Tonight it's myself, Dan, alongside Luke. How are you doing tonight, Luke?
I'm excellent. How are you, Dan?
Not bad. What'd you think of that game tonight?
It was an honorable loss. There's no shame in that. They tried hard. They lost to a better team, a markedly better team. Teams that draft first overall or threaten to draft first overall versus teams that are threats to win the whole shebang, you know. Results were predictable, though it's interesting that it's been 3 games now that they haven't scored a goal in Boston.
Yeah, and this game, unlike the game in Calgary, Jerome McGinley got an assist on both Boston goals tonight against his former team. I thought that was kind of interesting.
Mm-hmm. It's good to see. Good to see. I still like Iggy. I think everyone
does.
Yeah,
me too.
Good to see
him. I think
success.
Based on his reception when they were in town, I think we know that everyone still likes Iggy.
Oh yeah, for sure. That was really special. Not quite, you know, Montreal fans giving Maurice Richard a 6-minute ovation at the Forum. Everyone who wants to, if you ever want to cry, just go watch that. I recommend it highly. But it did get me thinking that I wonder, you know, we're probably not going to see that foreign athlete here for another 20 years. Minimum.
No. And I mean, Maurice Richard is a different caliber of player in the grand scheme of the NHL than Jerome McGinley as well.
Oh, for sure. But I meant to say is it was really sweet of Calgary to do what they did. And
his teammates, too. I mean, his teammates played along with the whole thing when he was here.
For sure. And the other point was also just to remind people of a great moment in hockey history that people probably would have forgotten about, maybe. I don't know. Anyway.
So over the next couple weeks when we're off for the holidays, people should go look that up.
They should. It's beautiful.
Awesome. Well, we got a lot to talk about this week, and most of it revolving around three people. Jay Feaster, John Weisbrod, and Brian Burke. So let's first talk about the big news, which was that Feaster and Weisbrod got let go last week. I think out of the blue. I don't think anyone was expecting it. Did you see it coming at all?
Only in the sense that you saw it coming eventually, that they would be fired. The timing was a little bit odd, but I agree with Burke that, you know, once you know you're going to do something, there's no sense beating around the bush about it. Let's just get it over. Like, he's been GM for 75 days during this investigation. I know I'm going to fire him. Why am I going to keep him around for another 3 weeks or whatever? Like, timing's not a little, it's a little surprising, but I'm indifferent to it.
Yeah, I mean, I was surprised by the timing. Normally when something like this happens, you hear rumors of it coming out, you hear kind of, you know, whispers through the NHL back channels, and this seemed to come right out of the blue. Like, nobody seemed to be expecting it.
Well, again, nobody seemed to be expecting it at that moment, but given what happened in the summer with Burt coming in the first place, and given rumors about Jay Feaster's job security for essentially since he took over the position, and then all of his foibles notwithstanding, I don't think it was surprising to anyone that he was ultimately relieved of his duties.
You know, it's interesting if you think about the comparison you mentioned about, you know, Feaster coming in. Feaster was brought in as the assistant general manager, kind of to be the advisor to Daryl Sutter at the time. And I think when that happened, everybody thought, okay, this guy's the heir apparent to the GM job. You don't bring in a guy with a Stanley Cup ring to be an assistant GM. And it's very similar, if you think about it, to the Brian Burke situation. He was brought in not to be the assistant, but kind of be the advisor, the guy on top. And the whole scenario really played itself out again.
Yeah, I think it does send a bit of a weird message from the Flames ownership perspective that if you work for us, rest assured, you're not just going to be fired. We're going to bring someone in to like shadow you for 3 months and then we're going to cut your legs off. That's kind of weird. I wish they'd stop doing that. Let's just fire someone, make a clean break. Have, you know, if you've got to fire your GM, have Conroy take over for a little bit until you find someone else. But this whole, oh, we're just going to make it, it's kind of high school bullshit.
So you think that you were saying you thought that Feaster would get fired eventually. So you thought this was the right move? You thought it was time for Jay Feaster to move on?
I think it was time for Feaster to move on, in all honesty. Now that I've had some time to think about it in the wake of the firing, the right time for him to go was immediately after the Ryan O'Reilly fiasco. I mean, you could have named Weisbrod interim GM and, you know, he could have just run the ball. Sorry, people who have complained about me talking about football. You could have just given Weisbrod the responsibility and let him do his thing for an off season, and then hired someone properly in the summer, or do an immediate intensive search, or reorganize your front office, whatever you were going to do. But there's this weird, like, half-assed, like, oh, we're not doing this because we want to look like good guys. But really, it's just like this. It's like some dude sending your girlfriend chocolates, but saying that like he's just her friend, or like they just work together, and it's like it's creepy.
See, I guess I have a different opinion than you do on the Burke thing, and I talked about this. I was on the Bash Brothers podcast this past weekend, and I said, you know, now that the Flames kind of put their faith in Feaster, if by no other reason than letting him start this season, I felt like they had to give him at least a season to see things through. I mean, he started this rebuild. He was the one who was responsible for drafting Monahan. He's the one who was responsible for getting rid of Jerome, that sort of thing. So I think that they owed it to him to at least let him see this through for a little bit. I know what you're saying about the Ryan O'Reilly thing, but I also think that a guy who's trying to improve his team as drastically as we were at the time, he had to make some take some risks and make some maybe sacrificial moves, and maybe it wasn't the right one, but I can't blame him for trying that move. So I would have, if it was me, I think, left him in for the rest of the season, unless there was a guy on the market who you absolutely had to have.
Well, here's the thing. I understand that Jay Feaster is the GM, or was the GM of this team, because the ownership wanted someone to basically do what he was told. And I also think that the fact that, you know, he starts this rebuild, he trades Jerome. I think his handling of both the Iginla and Bouwmeester trades, and maybe again, he was hamstrung a bit by ownership as well there. By not getting Iginla to sign something in writing that he'd go to any of four teams.
Well, who knows if that was him or Ken King either.
Well, I mean, whatever the situation was, like, that's an organizational oversight that it's not there. And if you're Jay Feaster, it's your bloody responsibility to know this stuff and to cover your bases. But, I mean, if you look at those two, Ryan O'Reilly and the Iginla trade alone, you look at that, demonstrates a fundamental misunderstanding of the CBA, or just pathologically bad decision making. And Iginla, for a lawyer, like it shows a level of disorganization and a lack of preparedness or knowing what to do in the face of pressure. Which is unbecoming of an NHL general manager.
Yeah, I can see where you're coming from on that. You know, again, I was also surprised it happened this quickly, because in the summer when Burke was brought in, they gave, you know, a lot of time to the whole Burke Feaster thing, and, you know, both sides saying, oh yeah, we're going to work together. You know, we've got this, we've got a plan going. So I guess I kind of thought that if they were going to get rid of Feaster, they would have done it right away when Berkey came in. So I guess it was surprising to me that it happened here, but I still don't think personally that they should have reevaluated the GM till the end of the year.
I think you look at it like this. How many GMs in the league would you take Jay Feaster over? 29?
Currently employed GMs?
Any GM. Currently employed. Would you choose Jay Feaster over 29 of them?
No.
How about 25 of them?
Maybe 20, 15, 20.
There's 20 GMs that you'd take, So
20 guys I'd rather have than Feaster at this point who are currently employed.
Okay. Exactly. So, given that that's just us who know very little about this team, would you not then think, okay, we've got a GM who's in the bottom third of the league. I don't care how hard he's trying or whatever. We are in a league that the goal is to be the best group of hockey players and hockey minds in the world. So, I'm no statistician, although I did take history in college. I'm not entirely sure how many best things in the world come from the bottom third of the class.
No, but we're also a team that has said that we're not going to be the best this year. We're a team that has said we need a couple of years to get to that point.
I'm not talking about the team. I'm talking about Jay Feaster's abilities as a general manager. And you just said that two-thirds of the league has a better general manager than us. And if that's the case, our GM needs to go.
But that's also why those GMs are employed. That doesn't necessarily mean that we're going to fire this one and find somebody better.
Of course. Why not? Like, the 20th... You really think that you couldn't do better with an unknown than the 20th best guy in the league? Because the 20th best guy in the league is just that. Like, the 20th best guy in the league in terms of overall talent evaluation, ability to manage a team, he doesn't just become the best GM, top five GM.
But we said it earlier, too. I mean, we don't know if he's been hamstrung by ownership. I mean, this guy has a cup. He's proven that he is one of the top, or has been at one point, one of the top guys in the league. We don't know enough to say that he's in that list because of Jay Feaster alone. It could be because of the way management or ownerships wanted him to manage this team. It could be because of the way Ken Kings wanted to manage this team.
No, but it does say something that the only job he was able to get after, admittedly, he was forced out of Tampa Bay and, you know, for not wanting to sign that Le Cavalier contract, which is understandable now, but his moves in Tampa Bay weren't great. His drafting was not good, except for Stamkos. He is a bottom tier general manager in the league. The entire core of his Lightning team was Rick Dudley's. Jay Feaster did not draft, I don't think three Jay Feaster drafted players were on the roster in Tampa Bay. And people on the internet will criticize Brian Burke for his Stanley, or not criticize, they'll put asterisks on his Stanley Cup in Anaheim because he brought in Solani, Beauchemin, Pronger. He brought in impact players, Paulson, Travis Moen, and Jay Feaster's tuning moves was Ruslan Fedotenko. And as much as that still stings from Game 7, Ruslan Fedotenko is not the same sort of assuring yourself a championship as acquiring the two of the three best defensemen of the modern age in their primes. And, you know, I'm just saying that Feaster was never going to get this team back to where it needed to be. You don't need a caretaker GM. The caretaker it doesn't work. You need someone with a vision. Feaster didn't really seem to have one. He wanted smart skills.
Now, in the current structure, do you think it's the GM that's going to get a vision, or do you think it's Brian Burke that's going to have the vision, and the GM has to buy into that?
I think Burke's going to hire someone who is of a similar mind. I don't think he's going to hire some dude who wants to go assemble the Montreal Canadiens. I think he's going to hire someone who thinks that, you know, big physical skill, you know, tough teams, that's what matters. But Brian Burke wants someone whose primary experience is in development and drafting and getting players to the next level. So basically, I mean, he's recognizing his own shortcomings, and he's not been a great drafter recently. So let's get someone in to be the GM who is a great drafter and just knows how to help assemble championship caliber teams.
You know, the first thing when the announcement was made that Feaster was fired, I immediately went to the Maple Leafs website, because I had this weird feeling in the back of my head that Dave Notis was going to announce his resignation from the Leafs. Come here, work with his old buddy.
Yeah.
I said, this weird feeling.
Well, if Dave Notis ever gets fired in Toronto and Burke is still here, you can rest assured Notis will be joining the staff.
In some role.
Oh, yeah. I don't. He may not be assistant GM or GM or whatever. Maybe he'll just be, like, vice president of hockey ops, and, like, he and Berkey can smoke cigars in the Avison Young Club or something. But Dave Notis will be here if he's ever out of a job.
So, Luke, I've been doing some research this week on possible candidates, names that have been thrown around, that sort of thing, for the GM job. Figured I'd run through some. I'm not sure how familiar you are with any of these candidates. In the press conference that Brian Burke did, he had suggested in that we may not need to go out and get someone with a lot of NHL experience, a guy who's been an NHL GM, because he thinks that within their structure, you can bring someone in who's a relative newcomer to the NHL, someone who has some management experience, maybe an AGM or a GM at a lower league, but they don't need a lot of NHL experience because Burke is kind of heading up the hockey ops. Do you agree with that?
I don't necessarily agree that this is going to be a difficult job to sell people on. Some people might hold out for better opportunities, whatever those may be, but the team is basically a blank canvas for you. So
yeah.
And if your interest is in development and scouting, Brian Burke's not going to touch you on that. Brian Burke's going to be there to, you know, lend his weight to trades and, you know, hit the home run when you need, you know, when you need it. He's going to be the Kirk Gibson in the Flames front office. I don't think he wants to be the guy who's like, no, we're going to draft this player and this player. He'll just be like, go get the best, biggest, meanest, most talented son of a bitch you can.
And some of the names have been thrown around. One of them was Joe Nieuwendyk. And that was the first name I think that everybody heard right after the whole thing happened, was the Flames have been given permission to talk to Nieuwendyk. Nieuwendyk is a guy with some NHL management experience. He's a Dallas GM. He was a Leafs AGM. He's got some experience in the office. He knows the players around the league. What would you think if Nieuwendyk were to come in as the new GM?
First of all, I'd just like to say it was announced tonight that no one has contacted Joe Nieuwendyk about anything.
Oh, really?
So
who announced that?
It was on Sportsnet during the game.
Okay.
But no, just no to Joe Nieuwendyk. There was nothing in Dallas that made me think he was an overly great GM. He was, you know, again, middle of the pack, and I want someone who is who's learned how to GM from the best of them. Someone, you know, like your Mike Fudas, Paul Fentons, and Jim Bennings, because, you know, they help build championship teams, or in the case of David Poile, you do more with less than anyone else in the league.
Well, let's talk about some of those guys you just mentioned. So Jim Benning is a former amateur scout for the Ducks. He's the current Boston assistant general manager. He's been working there for a number of years now, and he has a Stanley Cup ring. He won the Stanley Cup as the AGM of the Bruins in 2011. working under Peter Chiarelli. He's a guy that a lot of people think, and he's also been interviewed, as far as I understand, by the Sabres as a guy who's about ready to make that jump out of an AGM position into a GM position. Mike Fuda is a former OHL GM. He's the current director of amateur scouting for the Kings. So if you're talking about a guy you can draft well, there's a guy whose job it is to, you know the young players. And he's had success drafting big, tough teams in the past. If you look at some of the draft picks he's made and been a part of, he knows that side well. So he knows how to get a team that has some truculence.
Yeah, either would be great.
Couple other guys I've shortlisted. Some of these are names I've heard. Some are just names that I picked out looking around. One's David Poulin, former 17-year NHLer. He worked with Burke previously in Toronto. He was the VP of hockey ops for the Leafs at the time and the current GM of the Marlies. So a guy with some AHL experience who probably knows that development cycle a little bit.
I don't want to see cronyism. I would like them to go outside the tree. Get some new blood in here. Fresh ideas are what matter. Burke is the president now because he recognizes his own shortcomings. Let's hope he recognizes, you know, a need for fresh perspectives, not to have his buddies with him all the time.
And the other buddy of his that was named was Claude Lassell, former Tampa Bay assistant general manager and former AGM of the Milwaukee Admirals, and he was an AGM to Burke in Toronto. So another guy that was mentioned because he's a Burke crony. One guy that I found, no one's talked about this, but just looking around the league, is actually another former Flame player, Jason Botterill. Do you remember Jason Botterill?
I do. I remember him being on a World Junior team with Jerome McGinley, and I was a huge fan of his for reasons I can't remember. Yeah,
I didn't even know this, but he's the assistant general manager in Pittsburgh right now. So he's the AGM to Pete Chiarot there, and he's a former scout for Dallas. Former tough guy that would know what it would take to put a tough team on the ice. Maybe a guy worth calling. He definitely have a fresh perspective.
Some of my apprehension with Pittsburgh would simply be, okay, let's have the two best players in the world fall into your lap in successive draft years. Oh, and they both play center. That's always going to color just how much success you can have. But I suppose, you know, I'm sure he's very well qualified, and I wouldn't be opposed to him getting the job either if Burke sees that he's the guy. Yeah. I don't think he has quite enough player development experience, though.
No, but you're also going to bring in an AGM. You've got Burke here, you got Connie here. Like, you can surround him with good people who might have some of that experience.
Yeah, but he's the AGM in Pittsburgh, so if I'm going to be the AGM, I might as well be the AGM at, you know, for one of the crown jewel franchises of the NHL, where you're always around a Stanley Cup winning attitude and formula, and then when you're really ready to be a GM, you just take that leap. I wouldn't leave Pittsburgh to be an AGM if I were Botterill.
One reason I think Botterill might be a candidate too is that's a team that's, he knows what young player development looks like. I mean, they had two of the best in the world, but they've had, you know, young players in and out of that team for a while. So he probably knows some of the makeup that would go into a young team and how that team has to be treated and built and that sort of thing.
Maybe. I don't know if he was around for Pittsburgh's real growing phase where they, you know, they had Crosby, then they still picked third overall the next year and they sort of, you know, lost, learned to win, etc. I don't know if he was there for that, so I don't know how much credit he really deserves for their turnaround. But I just know that being around that sort of winning organization and atmosphere and understanding how to do things probably doesn't hurt, Scott Pioli aside.
He was, Botterill was promoted to his current position in 2009, so he's been there for a little bit now. And he was working in the organization before that. And then these names haven't been thrown around by the media, but just looking at what Flames fans have been telling us on social media and on other places online, some people are saying we should go with a proven name, somebody like a Rick Dudley, a guy who has NHL experience, but perhaps a guy who is looking to get back into the league as an NHL guy. Don Waddell's another guy who's been a GM in the past, isn't currently, but might want the job. Would you rather go with someone like a Benning or a Fuda who doesn't have NHL GM experience as opposed to a retread NHL GM?
That's entirely correct. I don't think there's a need to trot out these guys that don't seem to understand, not understand the game, but because Rick Dudley just signed an extension in Montreal. But, I mean, just guys who had their shot. Rick Dudley obviously has done good things, but he doesn't seem to want to be a GM anymore. Don Waddell, no. I'd much rather roll the dice with someone new than give some other person who hasn't gotten it done another shot. Burke at least got it done.
I'd be okay to bring one of those guys in kind of a consulting role. The way that it looked like they were building this team was to bring in, you know, a bunch of guys to work in hockey ops. But yeah, I agree with you. I wouldn't want one of them to be the GM. Maybe Don Waddell is an AGM. Yeah, I mean, he's got definitely some experience.
I know we were talking before the show about Darcy Regier being a GM, and I don't think he's an option at all. But as an assistant GM, absolutely.
And that might be a good idea. Bring in a rookie GM, give him a veteran, experienced AGM, and Brian Burke. You can make the guy look really good with that much NHL talent around him.
Yeah, and if he's too insecure to see the benefit of all the experience and knowledge, and assuming, you know, he has to set out also that they're ultimately, you know, it's his ship, or at least stand his ground a bit in the face of a couple who, what I'm sure, are intimidating veteran GMs in this league, you know.
But at the same time, if you bring in a guy like a Fuda or a Benning or a Botterill or any of these guys, and you put them with that talent, let's just say it was a Dudley or a Waddell and a Burke or even Regier, there's so much they can learn. Like, that's the way you want to mint a new GM, is put them with these guys who have this much experience and let them learn, and that could give you a great general manager down the road.
I agree 100%. And I am also saying that... in all likelihood, if you didn't relish the opportunity to work in that environment, you're probably weak.
Yeah, but I think, you know, in a situation like that, it'd be easy to replace that guy and either promote the AGM, give the reins back to Burke, or go find somebody else.
Well, you don't want someone who's going to be easy to replace, right? You want someone who's
got... No, but I mean, if it's not working out, or if the guy turns out not to be able to work in that environment...
No, I think that if that's even a consideration in your mind... You know, you can't hire him. Obviously, I mean, everyone's hired to be fired, but you want to hire a guy with the expectation that he can become the best general manager in the league. That's what we're after here. We're not after some placeholder or some guy who's like, oh, he's going to get us back to the playoffs. No, you hire someone who you think can join the ranks of Ken Holland, Lou Lamoriello, these guys, and you keep him as your GM for the next 30 years because he understands the game.
So you're thinking this is going to be a long-term GM, not just somebody for the next couple of years or somebody gets out of the rebuild?
It better be a long-term GM. If it's not, I'm going to be pissed off because they're wasting time.
Though, you know, you do need different managers at different times in a franchise. There are guys that you bring in to help you build a team and guys you bring in to help you win a franchise or win a title sometimes.
To a certain extent, but I think, again, like, do you think there's any situation that Mike Ilitch thinks Ken Holland isn't qualified to fix or see them through if Detroit decides to rebuild?
No, but Ken Holland's one of 30. I mean, he's probably the exception to the rule.
I know, but that's my point. You always want to be... That's who you want to hire. You want to hire someone you think can be the next Ken Holland.
Right, of course. But the actual chance of doing that is going to be low. Of course you're going to go out and get the best. Nobody goes and says, let's just get a piece to fill this. But whether it's a guy that's going to be here for 30 years, I think that might be stretching a little bit. Very few guys have ever been with one team for 30 years, like you said.
No, I understand that. I'm just saying that it doesn't make sense to me to have GMs for different phases of a team. I mean, it is, I suppose, one way to do it. If there's a guy who's very good at developing a farm system but somehow just isn't good at getting teams over the top, maybe that's an issue. But when you want to switch GMs up, but I mean, you have to think that, like, if you're looking that far into the future, that, I mean, obviously they don't come around all the time, but I'm just saying that's what you want. And that's what, if they go and hire Darcy Regier or a retread, then I know they're not thinking that with that in mind. So a new guy says to me, we think this guy can be the next Ken Holland. A retread says, well, these other guys really didn't want us to come here.
Though the last time we hired a new guy, we ended up with Craig Button as our GM, so it can go either way.
Well, that's fine. You still have to try, right? Like, you can't be afraid to... If a girl shuts you down, you can't be afraid to ask girls out for the rest of your life. You have to keep getting up there and trying.
No, but that's what I'm saying. If a guy can't perform in this, let's say they do give him all the staff they need, they bring in an experienced AGM, they give him Burke and he can't do it, get rid of him and bring somebody else in. That's what I was saying earlier. Like, you know, I think we have to set up a team where that GM, not that we want to do it, but that GM could be replaced and still have a team around them they can move forward with.
Well, everyone can be replaced. And I would argue in that situation that it's not that one person's fault. It's that the entire thing is probably dysfunctional and you would have to make a decision about individuals that you would keep. And I'm sure there'd be some sort of house cleaning, partial if not completely. But that's so far down the road, that's like, it's like preparing for a breakup on the first date.
Yeah, I guess, yeah, it depends how you look at it. I mean, like you said earlier, these guys are hired to be fired. No, you're not wanting to fire them, but you know at some point, you've got to, I guess, build a system around one guy would be my preference. So it's not just, okay, we lost our GM, like now, we lose the GM, we lose the AGM, we start all over again. Is build up a team there. And if the GM needs to change, you've still got your scout, your AGM, your president of hockey ops, whatever, who can still keep some consistency going.
Well, but if things aren't getting done, perhaps the consistency is the problem, or the level of the consistency of the people in the room.
Could be, but there could be a lot of other reasons why it's not working too. So you're right. I mean, yes, if it's the people that aren't working, of course you fire them all. But I'm just saying, if we bring in a rookie and you're surrounding with these, you know, veterans like Burke, like Waddell, like, you know, Regier, just naming some Dudley, those kind of guys, it's very possible that they may just feel overwhelmed, or, you know, a number of different situations might happen where it's not necessarily the room, it's just they're not cut out for that job in that environment. Does that mean it's the bad environment? Does that mean everyone should be fired? I don't think so.
Well, it means you have to rethink how you're doing things at the very least. I don't think you... Well, whatever. Maybe it does, maybe it doesn't.
So do you think that the next GM will be able to be his own thinker, or do you think he'll essentially be Burke's puppet?
Again, I said this earlier. I don't think Burke wants to be the GM. I think Burke is the help off. He comes off the bench to help in trades, and he has a philosophy that he sets the tone for the organization, but I don't think he's interested in running day-to-day operations. And yes, there's a chain of command, but I don't think... Brian Burke is not the sort of person who'd come in to be a yes man to Murray Edwards.
No.
So I'm not worried.
So you think that Burke has finally kind of resigned that he's not running this team? Whether he did when he came here or not, you think that he does want to be hands off? He wants to bring someone in who can run their own team?
Yeah. Well, I when I say hands off, I don't mean he's not going to... I don't know. I don't mean that he's going to be just completely absentee or whatever, but I think he's going to be prevalent in the organization. I just think that there's certain responsibilities the GM is going to have that he will not really touch, like player development, like drafting and scouting and that sort of stuff.
I don't know about that. I mean, I won't debate what I think his role is, but I think he is going to be prevalent in scouting. I think part of his role is to go out and look at guys the scouts want another opinion on because the GM's on the road, that sort of thing. So I think he is going to have a hand in scouting.
I mean, maybe. I mean, he's a hockey guy. You'd be foolish not to sort of get his opinion on things, but ultimately they're just doing it. So if Brian Burke does that, I'm sure it's to augment the decision of the GM, not to make a final decision. Because if you want to get Mike Fuda out of LA or Jim Benning, you're not going to be able to.
Yeah. And that's the only reason I'm asking that question, is I've heard a lot of people within the hockey media wondering if Burke can stay hands off or if he's going to get quite involved with the new GM. I think you're right. I think that he'll be able to stay hands off. He will do his job, which you're right, is not absenteeism. If it was absenteeism, he wouldn't be good for anybody in his role. But yeah, I think you need to give that new GM space to do their own thing and run this team on their own and not just do, you know, not always look to Burke, even though he is that mentor and that sort of thing, to just say, you know, what would you do? What would you do? What would you do? The only guy left in our front office now is Craig Conroy, and it was made clear at the press conference they held that Connie is not the GM at this point. Burke says he will one day be an NHL GM. I don't think there's any question in anyone's mind that he stays with the Flames. I think he's definitely going to stay here. Whether he stays as kind of that special assistant or they move him full-time to Abbotsford where he's the GM this year, do you think that he will get promoted to AGM at all, or do you think he just kind of stays where he's at?
I'm not sure what's going to happen with him, to be honest. I hope he sticks around. If Burke thinks he's going to be a GM in the league one day, it would behoove him to keep him around in some sort of advisory capacity or doing what he's doing with Abbotsford this year. And, you know, maybe he's a not an heir apparent, but just someone who you could promote from within in the event of the current new GM flopping. But in that case, I would get rid of Conroy as well and let him go try his wares elsewhere, because whatever he's been a part of hasn't worked or whatever. I don't know.
Yeah, well, and it could be a case where they bring in a new AGM. That AGM is good, gets another job somewhere, and Connie comes up eventually. But I'd probably keep him on at this point if the new GM doesn't want him as part of his team as the AHL GM, because, I mean, our AHL team is doing good this year. Who knows how much that's Connie's doing, but you know, he's not hurting the team, obviously. And I think it's probably good for the team from a PR perspective to have Connie there. He's well-spoken. He does a lot of media stuff. So it's probably a good idea for them to keep him
around. For sure, especially if they're still going to insist on playing their AHL team in the backyard of the Canucks.
Yeah. Weren't they going to... Didn't they try to move that team to New York State or something last year?
Sort of, but Vancouver wouldn't give them enough money for the affiliation, and that's hilarious.
So the Flames were trying to sell this franchise to Vancouver, yeah. And they were... Okay, I think so. And then they were going to get a new franchise.
I think so, but I don't think they wanted to, but I do think they were just like, see, well, what are you going to give us? What are you going to give us? And then when it didn't happen, it's like, no, we're not doing this to you. Huh. We're not doing you a favor.
I remember talking about that on the show. It seemed like it was a done deal at one point. I know you and I have talked, and you've talked on the show about getting the teams to be a bigger, meaner team. As Brian Burke likes to say, more truculent team. I think it's a good idea. Burke said in his press conference that if you look at every team that's won the Cup in recent memory, they've all been bigger teams, they've been meaner teams. And as soon as he said that, the first thing I thought to myself was, hey, don't let Sven's plane leave yet. Paul Byron's going to have to get on it because he's not big and mean. Do you think it's a good way to go? Do you think it's a sound strategy to say that we have to get bigger and meaner?
Yes.
Add some truculence?
Absolutely. Like, it's no surprise, it shouldn't be anyway, to see that a team that's this small and this soft gets consistently pushed around and is constantly injured. Having Brian McGrattan is nice, but there are too many players that... can't handle an 82-game NHL season.
And Gratz can't protect all 18 guys.
I'm not even... I mean, I think the notion of enforcers protecting other players is vastly overrated. Brian McGrattan didn't stop Brad Marchand from plastering Sean Monahan tonight. Not that I don't see a role for Brian McGrattan, but it is different than what I think the perception of it is to be.
I thought it was funny that Burke had to come out and say that, because I kind of thought that was a given, that a team should be big. They should, you know, have truculence, that sort of thing. I thought it was weird that he had to come out and say that, almost as though that was a strategy going forward. Maybe that had a big part of the reason why Feaster's gone now, but it just seemed to me when he said it, it's like, well, of course.
Well, Jay Feaster is a man who makes change for change's sake, and while he does learn from his mistakes in a sense, he never learned that basically not having a concrete vision, a well-thought-out plan, and basically flying by the seat of your pants is not a way to run a hockey team. You can look at there's two sides to every move, obviously, and you can look at every single one of Jay Feaster's acquisitions in recent memory, impact ones. You look at Weidman, Russell, Hudler, the list goes on. Players that aren't bad players, but don't fit necessarily on a team, on this team. We have five defensemen who are various levels of the same player, or various incarnations. Giordano, Brody, Weidman, Russell, and Butler are all less physical. Not so much Gio, but and Weidman, I know he's been hip-checking people, but, I mean, Weidman's never going to be confused for Chris Pronger. Less physical, offensive, flashy D. Although, and obviously you hope Brody's going to become Dan Boyle, but they are redundant on the same team.
Yeah, and you know, looking back over the last couple of days at Feaster and the team he assembled here, it seemed like he had no plan. It was just, let's go out and grab whoever we can. There didn't seem to be a certain type of player that was a Calgary Flames player. If you remember when Daryl Sutter was here, he was kind of going for the big, mean, what a lot of people called the Western Canadian players. You know, and I think that's more what Burke was probably saying when you think about it, of we need to put an identity on who we want here, and that's the identity.
Yeah, we when you say things like you need to be able to help this team win or you need to be able to help Abbotsford win, I don't know what that means. And like I know that, okay, yeah. That's like,
well, that's the whole point. You're a professional athlete. That's what you're paid for, is to win. Yeah, it's like a kid growing up saying, I want to help people. Well, do you want to be a doctor? Do you want to be a policeman, a fireman? Like, you know, what are you going to do specifically to get that done?
Yeah, too many buzzwords and not enough, I don't know, identity or plan. I think the lack of a plan, players can sense it. They're not idiots. They may not be great quotes, but they're smart guys. It's very easy to tell when the person above you has no idea what's going on and your workers are less inclined to help as a result.
I was talking to some people this week on a Google Hangout with some Flames fans, and it was an interesting point that was brought up, and I brought this up earlier in the year. It seemed like the Flames were starting to get some guys that were harder hitters and stuff, but some people in this Google Hangout were saying, if you think about it, that mean team, like I said earlier tonight, that kind of Daryl Sutter mentality, things have gone almost full circle in that way. If that was Daryl's type of team, we got away from that, and now we're coming back to that.
Yeah, I mean, here's the thing. Daryl Sutter wasn't necessarily wrong in his overall philosophy. Big, tough, physical teams that play good defense and have great goaltending. Does that sound familiar?
He just didn't execute that correctly.
Yeah, he wasn't the best evaluator of the talent to get that, but he was going in the right direction. And there was such a pallor cast over the organization when he left. Obviously, people are going to go for the anti-Daryl. But, I mean, the result of that was a complete, basically, abdication of responsibility for everyone, because the organization had essentially a policy of sort of anything goes.
Yeah. Yeah, I think, you know, it shows that he was onto something. He had the right overall idea, because that's the idea we're going back to. It just needs to be executed, perhaps, better than Daryl executed it.
Well, clearly better than what Daryl had done. But when Daryl's not the GM, he's the best, one of the best coaches in the game.
Yeah. So let's move on a little bit. Unless there's anything else you want to talk about the GM search. Hopefully we'll find out soon. I'm hoping that they'll have somebody before the new year, I think would be a good thing for this team. But
if there's a ticking clock, I would assume so, yes.
Yeah, well, that's the whole thing. As Burke said, there's a ticking clock. They wanted to make this move so they could interview the same people that the Sabres are. So, yeah, I have a feeling there is going to be a ticking clock on this team.
Good. Exciting times.
You were mentioning before the show tonight how much you were liking Paul Byron. What about him are you liking right now?
Well, he had 4 points in two games. He's been really chasing down people. His skating's been terrific. He's been making really nice passes. It's just, you know, I don't expect him to be here long-term. He's a replacement-level player, but it's, you know, nice to see him have some success.
So you're at least happy with one half of the Robin Regier trade.
No. Let's not confuse things here. Robin Regier, 2 years after he was in his prime and after two, frankly, subpar years, still got 2 second-round picks from the Buffalo Sabres. And this is another reason Feaster should have been fired. Getting Butler and Byron and having to give up a second for Robin Regier is also a fireable offense. Or at least it should be. That should have been, you know, right away. And I apologize to people who we, you know, I've constantly fought with on the internet about Feaster not being all that bad. I was wrong, you were right. I just didn't see the point in being overly pessimistic and hoping, and I just, you know,
hope for
the best.
That was Feaster's first move after being named GM, wasn't it? Or was he still interim at the time?
I don't know if he was interim or not, but it was a, boy, was that a, you know, step in the right direction. That really, that whole trade set the tone for Feaster's tenure. A bunch of god-awful trades that see us lose and confusion and the lack of understanding and why these people. Butler, Byron, I'll say it, Kandarian, Berra, Hanowski and Agostino, like... It, oh, God. The, as much as I like some of the drafting he ended up doing... His inability to close deals just is going to hold this team back so much.
But, you know, I think it's not too late to fix that, which is a nice thing. Like, the next guy can come in and still has a clean slate he can work with.
No, I mean, it's not like an unfixable situation by any stretch, but the mistakes he made are unfixable. You can't... You're never going to... get back the chance to get value for a great defenseman and a great forward. And as much as we all, me especially, I gave Jabo a rough time, I think we're...
He was a good defenseman.
He was a terrific defenseman. And
sometimes you don't realize what you've lost until you've lost it.
Yeah, I know. The grass is always greener or something. And I ultimately still think that his attitude around this team at this stage would not have been helpful. But... He's a very good player.
But, you know, I think it's still early in this rebuild. Like you said, we can't get value back for things that we didn't get value for, but it's not like we've got a core here that has to be moved out and start the rebuild again. We're still early enough in it. And I commend Burke for that he made this move early enough that the next guy can come in and keep going with what we've already got in place.
Yeah, I mean, this rebuild is... you know, less than a year old. Thankfully, Feaster and Wisebrod did not screw up this last draft. It seems like we got very good value with all of our first-round picks, including Morgan Klimchuk, who signed his entry-level deal today. But...
Yeah, that was a 3-year deal worth $950,000 a year. So the other first-round pick, the guy that people forget was drafted after Monahan in the first round. People always just think it's money.
My point was he didn't screw up this draft. He drafted good pieces, but you never wanted Jay Feaster to rebuild this team. Just flat out. It is settling to let Jay Feaster rebuild this team. And we're not settling. We're out on the hunt for the next Ken Holland. And if we're not, then there needs to be more change. But I think we are. And it'll be... it's an exciting time to be a fan of the team.
And I think that's something we do have to give Jay credit for. As much as, you know, we've kind of talked about his shortcomings today, he came into a team with a lot of bad contracts. And we might say that he perhaps didn't get as much back as he could, but he really was able to move those and free himself from those bad contracts and not create any more. So he was, you know, in a lot of ways, he made forward progress during his time here.
He did. I'll say this. I think Jay Feaster did the best he could during his time here, full on. That's the problem. Jay Feaster's best isn't going to get it done in this league. So, yeah, and that's why the change needed to be made. So put that on a t-shirt.
Well, Luke, this is our last episode of the 2013 calendar year. We're going to take a couple weeks off for the holidays.
Yay!
I hope you and your family have great holidays. All of our fans have great holidays. Have a restful holiday, and we'll come back in January energized and ready to talk Flames hockey again.
Absolutely. Suck it, Tom. Merry Christmas, everybody.
We are the boys of Chorus. We hope you like our show. We know you're rooting for us, but now we have to go.
Fireside Chat Podcast, produced and edited by Dan Stevenson.